Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Macedonian Hazard, a Ring of Fire novel by Eric Flint, Paula Goodlett, and Gorg Huff. Narrated by P.J. Ochlan. Prologue. Build, sell, or die. Queen of the Sea, off the coast of Trinidad, November 28th, 321 BCE. Stella Matthews lay on the bed in her cabin on the Queen of the Sea and watched TV. Stella was 52 years old, a bit overweight, recently divorced, with two adult children left behind by the event, and was on the Queen of the Sea to, as the movie said, get her groove back. Being dropped into the 4th century before the Common Era was not helping Stella get her groove back. The fact that she was going to be dumped off the Queen of the Sea with nothing but her luggage and some so-called money that was sucked out of Eleanor Kinney's thumb wasn't doing anything for her groove either. So she wasn't goofing off watching TV. She was studying. There were recorded programs that could be watched on demand. The one she was watching was a discussion including Allen Wiley, who was the president of New America, his assistant Amanda Miller, Eleanor Kinney, and a few others. "As you all must know by now," Kinney was saying, "there is no way that the Queen of the Sea can support the passengers indefinitely. That, as much as the oil, is why we're here." Allen Wiley nodded his politician's head, with his face a picture of grave concern. "We will need to build ourselves a new nation here in the past, grow our own food. There is no way that the colony on Trinidad will be able to grow its own food this year, and probably not next year either," Kinney interrupted. "With all the hard work and goodwill in the world, it takes time for plants to grow. The colony, New America," Wiley interrupted in turn. "New America?" Kinney agreed with a nod at Wiley, then looked back at the camera. "New America is going to have to buy all or almost all its food for at least the next year. Probably the next 3 to 5 years. Some of that will come from oil, but not all. There are only two ways that New America can support itself: manufacturing and trade. This is different from previous colonies because this is the largest initial colony that we have been able to find. Not that we've looked that hard," she smiled at the camera. "But the Mayflower carried 102 passengers and about 30 crew to the New World. We will be more than 2,000. They kept talking, but Stella, a legal secretary, didn't have a clue what she might build or sell. There probably weren't going to be a lot of lawsuits for her to type up and file. They went on talking about who owned the oil well, and for that matter, the oil field. The oil field was owned by the colony, and the oil rig was owned by the investors, which included the Queen of the Sea, some of the crew from the Reliance, the colony, and the Roughnecks working on it. There would be a dividend, but Stella could do the math. Especially financial math. It was unlikely that she was going to be able to live off the annual dividend. I'm going to need a job." Fort Plymouth, Trinidad, December 8th, 321 BCE. Stella looked at the lot marked by sticks in the grass-covered sandy soil and silently raged. She knew perfectly well that her rage was fueled by terror, but there was a lot of terror to fuel it. Her hunt for a job wasn't going well. It wasn't that there wasn't work for secretaries. It was that there were a lot of secretaries on the Queen of the Sea when the event happened. And several of them had better ins with the new government than Stella did. All Stella had was her buyout from her room on the Queen of the Sea. The money she got as the buyout of her share of the Queen of the Sea, along with a mortgage, was paying for this piece of land and the townhouse to be built on it here in Fort Plymouth. The deal was that 50% of the combined cost of the land and construction was covered by the buyout, and the rest was a loan at 3% annual interest. The total cost was 40,000 New America dollars, and she would pay out the other half over 10 years, along with paying for her food and drink, at the community center. She would be eating at the community center because her house wasn't going to have a kitchen for the foreseeable future. Very few of the houses in Fort Plymouth were going to have kitchens. Having a kitchen of your own upped the cost of a townhouse by over 10 grand. She had no idea how she was going to get the money to make the payments on the basic townhouse. For the moment, she had 5 grand in the bank from the sale of her cell phone to the ship, and that was going to go away in about 10 months' worth of payments. That was what the stakes were for, marking out her part of the block of townhouses that were to be built together. It wasn't much of a townhouse. 750 square feet, one bedroom, one workroom, a closet that was supposed to be a bathroom once they got running water, no kitchen. They claimed that it would have electricity and plumbing as soon as they could manage it. For now, it was going to be built with a place for the wires and pipes. She looked over to her left to see an old white guy with a walker. He was looking at the lot next to hers. After a moment, she recognized him. He had been in the cabin next to hers on the Queen of the Sea. 2 internal cabins with no windows translated into 2 apartments in Fort Plymouth.
"You weren't using a walker on the Queen."
He looked at her and started to bristle, which Stella welcomed. She could really use a yelling match right now. Someone, anyone to have a fight with would help. But then the cowardly bastard deflated, just looking sad and old.
"The Queen had elevators and carpeted halls. Besides, I didn't have to go very far at any given time. There was always some place to sit."
Stella nodded and introduced herself. He was Donald, call me Don, Carnegie. 77 years old and a retired plumber who smoked for 50 years and was about to take it up again because with his diabetes, he was going to die soon anyway. The natives used tobacco in pipes, had for who knew how long. Don figured why the hell not. At least he'd die happy. Work area. Fort Plymouth, Trinidad. December 15, 321 BCE. The half-tent, roof, no walls, was part of the gear from the Queen. Now it was filled with benches as Stella joined the work crew. A man waved her over and directed her to a chair. The crude bench table in front of her had a rough wooden framework for slats with strips of thin wood crisscrossed between them, and a bucket of gray-brown-looking goop. There was also a flat piece of wood with a handle sticking into the goop in the bucket. Once everyone was seated, the man held up one of the frameworks and said,
"This is wattle. It's just a thin framework of just about anything, and its only purpose is to provide a place to put the daub."
He set down the wattle framework and picked up a bucket.
"This is daub. It's basically mud. A little more complicated than that, but not much. It's pretty similar to the stuff you would use to make mud bricks. Your job is to use the trowel."
He held up a flat piece of wood with a handle like the one in Stella's bucket of mud.
"And use it to spread the daub on the wattle in a smooth, even coat. And have care, folks. This is liable to be part of the wall of your house. And if it's not yours, it will be one of your neighbors."
They got to work, and it was hard work. The daub was thick, and spreading it evenly over the wattle took effort. You had to pick up the wattle and rotate it to reach the far end. It took 10 to 15 minutes to finish a panel. Then you would raise a hand, and an inspector would come around with a cart, look at it, and either point to places where the daub was uneven or didn't cover everything, or put it on the cart to be taken to the drying shed. It was hard work, but it paid 15 bucks an hour in ship credit, and Stella was going to need every dime of that. 214 12th Street, Fort Plymouth, Trinidad, December 28, 321 BCE. Stella climbed the short bamboo ladder to the ground floor that was 4 feet above the ground. President Wiley promised that they would get plumbing using bamboo as soon as possible, But for now, there were composting toilets that amounted to honey buckets that would be picked up by carts that would come around daily. The flooring was rough planking with gaps. You wouldn't fall through, but it was obvious that speed was the controlling factor in construction. No time was spent on fitting or finishing. The names of the streets were, for now at least, based on a grid of numbers and letters, and your place in town was based on your room on the ship. 12th Street was populated with passengers from Deck 6 aft inboard. It wasn't a law. If you had the money, you could buy any plot of land you wanted in Fort Plymouth or outside it. But there was a discount for taking what was offered, and Stella was not flush. The townhouses were two-story post and daub buildings made of wood post panels. The panels consisted of a network of twigs that were then filled in with daub, the same stuff used to make mud bricks. They were made in standard frames in a central location and then carted to the townhouses to be installed. The second story was more of a loft than an actual second story, 6 feet high at the back and 10 at the front. The floors were wood, split logs. The locals, one of the native tribes, built their houses on stilts, so they had logs. The Queen of the Sea fabricated a bunch of log splitters to turn logs into rough planking. But the labor involved made that expensive, so they only used it for the flooring. The walls were the mud daub. That was also the reason for townhouses. They were easier to build them in a batch than as individual houses. It also saved room, which the wall around Fort Plymouth put at a premium. Her townhouse now had a shape, but was still weeks away from livable. She went next door to look at Donald Carnegie's place. He wasn't up to making the visit himself, but he did know about plumbing, so he was working on the Queen with the 5 other plumbers who happened to be on the ship when the event occurred. Not that she or Don were going to get indoor plumbing anytime soon. January 17th, 320 BCE. Moving day. Stella walked behind Donald as he lifted the walker with each step. He was on a limited diet now, to try to help with the diabetes, but it wasn't working. Not really. He was shaky and had trouble walking. When they got to the stairs up to the ground floor, she took the walker and lifted it to the front walk while he held the railing. Then she helped him up the 4 steps to the wooden sidewalk, or front porch, depending on how you thought of it. Once up, she helped him into his front room where there was a chair and a bed, both of which were pulled from the Queen as the interior rooms on the ship were converted to workshops rather than sleeping places. Stella, without the income from helping design the plumbing system for Fort Plymouth that Don earned, was making do with a locally made bed, reeds in a sack on rope supports in a wood frame. Stella wasn't trained to be an old man's helper. She'd been a legal secretary who had spent her entire working life in a lawyer's office. She knew how to punctuate a tort, not how to take care of a sick old man. Once she got Don situated, she went back to her house, got her laptop, then headed to the computer center. The computer center was 5 blocks away on 7th Street, near the center of town, a larger building with a steam-powered generator to charge batteries and power computers. Stella used her ship ID card as her credit card to clock in. Use of the computers wasn't free. Neither was use of the charging station and the network link that let her hook her laptop up to the larger computers and drives that held copies of Wikipedia and the Encyclopedia Britannica, but it was cheaper than using one of the computers for rent. Still, even using the charging station to charge her computer's batteries was another reason for making do with locally made furniture. She was researching glassmaking, because Lisa Hammonds from Deck 8, Cabin 8235, said that it was simple. Stella didn't believe it, but she was going to find out. While her computer was downloading the Wikipedia and Britannica articles on glassmaking, Stella thought back a few days to the discussion. Queen of the Sea, Lido Deck, January 14th, 320 BCE.
"Isn't glassmaking complicated?" Stella had asked.
"Nope. Glass is sand, potash, and if you want clear glass, you flavor it with a little lead oxide," It's also the first industry started in the New Plymouth Colony in, like, 1620.
And where are you going to get lead oxide and potash?
Stella didn't mention sand, because she pretty much knew that Lisa would point at the beach if she did. But she was almost sure that just any sand wouldn't do. You needed some special sort of sand.
They call it pot ash because it's ashes that you mix with water in a pot to leach out the stuff you want. It comes from the ashes of plants, especially water plants. Seaweed.
She pointed at the beach where there was a line of seaweed at the high tide line.
As for the lead oxide, that might be harder, at least here. But it's just lead ground into powder because lead rusts really fast. That's why lead isn't shiny.
So why aren't you planning on glassmaking? Stella asked.
Because I've got a degree in electrical engineering. That's not as good as a mechanical engineer in this time, but somebody needs to design the electrical systems for Fort Plymouth and figure out how to make radios for when the ones we have wear out. And if I live long enough, build computers.
Lisa Hammonds was 33, on vacation with her husband Richard, who taught English Lit at the University of Tennessee. They shared an outboard cabin with a balcony before the event. Between that and what Lisa was making helping to design Fort Plymouth's electrical grid and the larger payout for the bigger room, they would have over 1,500 square feet and be nearer the computer building and Capitol building. Once those got built. Computer Center, Fort Plymouth, Trinidad, January 18, 320 BCE. The download finished. Stella started reading the articles while her computer's battery charged. Glassmaking was more complicated than Lisa implied. For one thing, you didn't make glass in a crock pot or a smoker. You needed heat, the sort of heat you needed to make pottery. 2,450 degrees Fahrenheit. Not much less than the melting point of steel. That in turn meant you needed a kiln. Then you needed a different kiln to anneal the glass after you made it, or it would shatter. At least, that was the impression that the mishmash of articles was giving her. As soon as her computer was fully charged, Stella put it carefully in its carrying case, and with the strap over her shoulder, headed home. It started to rain while she was in the computer center, so at the corner of every block, she walked down steps onto a street that had turned to mud, slogged through the mud to the next block of townhouses, went back up four steps to the wooden walkway, then the same again for seven blocks. Fortunately, because of the way the townhouses were made, the walkway was covered by the second-story balcony.
Little boxes, she half-muttered.
Then she couldn't remember some of the song and continued,
and they're all made out of ticky-tacky, and they all look just the same.
She knew why that was. It was because standardization made for faster, cheaper construction. And building housing for 3,000 people wasn't cheap, no matter how you did it. Once Stella got home, she dried off using a dirty towel because laundry was expensive now, too. Then, using the same towel, she dried her computer case and pulled out her computer. Then she knocked on Donald Carnegie's door and tried to interest him in glassmaking as a business. 214 12th Street, Fort Plymouth, Trinidad, March 12, 320 BCE. The kiln design was mostly out of Wikipedia, but Donald had helped. It turned out that plumbing helps with preheating air to make the fire hotter. Something called reverse flow. The air came in right next to where the burned air went out, so the flue preheated the air. Stella was the one who wrote up the variance request that let them put the kiln behind the house in the 50-foot field that went between the houses and the town wall. Stella had never in her worst nightmare imagined that she would be living in a walled fort. The wall was going to be 18 feet tall when it was finished. April 14th, 320 BCE. Stella helped Donald up the stairs to the second floor, then out onto the balcony, so they could watch the Queen of the Sea sail out. The second floor was 14 feet above the ground after adding the 4-foot crawl space below the first floor. That put Donald and her eyes a touch above the wall, so out in the bay she could see the queen clearly. She looked over at Donald and saw a tear leaking onto his cheek. And Stella wanted to cry too, because she knew as well as Donald did that he would probably not live to see the Queen of the Sea return to Fort Plymouth. She helped him back inside, and they sat for a while as she waited for him to get enough energy to make it down the stairs. The stairs were sort of actual stairs, though they were like the stairs on a warship. They had flat rungs, but the angle was closer to a ladder than what Stella thought of as stairs. They did have extra steps, so Donald didn't need to lift his feet that far to reach the next step. Once Stella got Donald situated, she went out to the hardware store near the center of town to buy tar. The hardware store did indeed have hardware. It had hammers, though it had more wooden hammers than steel hammers, and the wooden mallets were quite a bit cheaper. It had brushes and buckets, mostly handmade. The tar she was here to buy came in chunks. It was a waste product of the oil refinery, a still located near the oil well a few miles out of town. The tar was the crud that collected on the bottom of the still and was mucked out by hand. It was also the best sealant for cracks in the roof, floor, and walls in the townhouses of Fort Plymouth. And Stella and Donald's townhouses had a lot of cracks to be filled. One good thing was that Stella was losing weight. She was doing quite a bit of hard manual labor every day, between emptying the chamber pots, sweeping the floors, building the kiln, and today using a pot stove on the balcony to melt the tar. It stank, and would stink even after it cooled for days. It was a tar paper shack without the paper. Once she had the tar melted, it went up onto the roof by buckets as local tribesmen painted the roof with it, to give her and Donald, for the first time since they moved in, roofs that didn't leak. The back of Stella's townhouse was up against the 50-foot field, a 50-foot stretch of open ground between the town and the town's wall. The field was designed to let defenders move from one point on the wall to another easily, but Stella got a 10-foot variance to build her kiln out back. The kiln was brick, 2 layers thick, and it had a preheating chamber and was oil-powered. Why not? She lived only a few miles from an oil well. It was also, after months of her work and the occasional labor of the locals, not quite completed yet. Community Center, Fort Plymouth, Trinidad, April 19, 320 BCE. The community center was a combination restaurant, general grocery, half open-air gaming area, and live theater. There was even a big screen TV from the Queen in one room that played movies from back in the world. At the moment, Stella was sitting at a table, eating cornbread and chili beans with enough super turkey meat to make it almost real chili. The peppers were as local as the super turkey. They grew all over this part of South America, and the Tupki were selling them to the colony by the canoe load. Everything from fresh to smoked and dried. Chili was almost like home. Well, except for the people who insisted that chili wasn't supposed to have beans in it. Next to Stella on the bench was Carol Knight Harvell. Carol was 45 and worked as a domestic before the event. The trip on the Queen was her second honeymoon, and her husband, John Harvell, had been a truck driver in Chicago. They had 3 adult kids who had not made the trip and were committed Christians before the event. They were both working at other businesses now. John was working on one of the steam generators. His job was to watch the dials, control the crude oil that the steam engine burned for fuel, and make sure the steam engine ran at a consistent speed. The sole function of his steam engine generator was to charge a bank of lead-acid batteries that were then used to power electrical devices. That system was in use because here in New America, they lacked the control systems to avoid power spikes. Carol, on the other hand, worked in the condom factory.
"You have nothing to complain about," Carol told Stella. "I spend my whole day with a wooden dildo in my hand, dipping it into a pot of hot latex, then sticking it under a blow dryer, then dipping it again until the condom is thick enough not to rip. Then I turn it over to Tess Panai while I grab another dildo and do it all again. I've handled more woodies since we got here than in my whole family for generations back. Stella didn't want to talk about the utter and complete lack of woodies of any sort in her life since the event. So she changed the subject, and they talked about some of the new industries that were starting up in Fort Plymouth. They were all kitchen industries, wood shops and leather workers, manufacturers of latex water bottles, and some guy trying to make a sewing machine. Another guy was trying to get a jacquard loom built, and someone actually had a pedal-powered carding machine up and running. After lunch, Stella went back to the counter and got a salad to go for Donald, which she carried back. Donald Carnegie was sitting on the wooden sidewalk in front of his townhouse. His head was lolling to the side and his mouth was open. There was some drool leaking, and Stella tried to wake him. He wouldn't wake up. She checked his heartbeat. It was still beating, but he was barely breathing at all. She shouted to William McKeon, their next-door neighbor on the other side. "Donald is unconscious! Run, get the medics!" The medics arrived about 15 minutes later and took him away in a two-wheeled cart pulled by two men. Fort Plymouth Hospital, Trinidad, April 21, 320 BCE. President Allen Wiley stepped into the ward and looked around. This was the experimental ward. There were 12 cots, six on each side of the room, and about half the beds were filled. These patients were the ones with terminal illnesses that would have been merely chronic back in the world. The beds emptied and were refilled on a regular basis as the healers tried to do what they could, and in the process did human experiments. Al went over to the doctor, Ronald Kemper, who had been a registered nurse back before the event. Ronald looked up from the patient he was injecting.
"It's fish-derived insulin, Mr. President, and not nearly as pure as I would like. But this guy is in a diabetic coma and headed to the grave if we don't do something."
"Did you have his permission?" Al asked. Ronald nodded.
"It's on the chart. We can try anything we want."
It was a standard question that all the citizens of New America were asked to fill out, even before they moved off the ship. Donald's eyes flickered. The insulin was working. May 15th, 320 BCE. Ronald Kemper pulled the sheet up over Donald Carnegie's head. The allergic reaction to the insulin contributed to a chest infection, which in Donald's weakened state proved fatal. Other patients were doing fine, at least for now, on the fish-derived insulin that was only purified by centrifuge. But there were too damned many who died from allergy to the non-insulin element that the poor purification methods left in the juice. And even for those it did work for, there were often side effects. Gradual damage to the fatty tissue around the injection points. Other things. He got up and scratched his head. He was a nurse, a surgical nurse, and a good one. Not a doctor, much less an expert in experimental medicine, which was what they needed. 214 12th Street, Fort Plymouth, Trinidad, May 16th, 320 BCE. Stella looked around Donald's room in the double townhouse that was now hers. Donald's will left her everything he had. She lived upstairs in her side, and there was another room just like hers in Donald's side that he never occupied. She would move the bed and the chair up to her room and happily get rid of the sack full of reeds. This floor, the ground floor, was designed to be a workshop. She spent 2 hours cleaning and packing everything Donald had. It wasn't much. Some clothes and a book reader. Donald spent most of his time reading after the event. He told her that he was never much of a reader before, but he was so weak after that he couldn't do much else, and the nearest TV was in the community center. Once she was done with his room, Stella went next door to look at her latest failure to make glass.
She used a pry bar to break open the mold and looked at the roughly lens-shaped piece of flint. The glass kiln in the back was up and operational, although the fire bricks weren't of the quality she wanted. But as the dark gray object indicated, the real problem was that in spite of having all the equipment and reading up on it, she had no clue how to make glass. She needed an expert, and though there was one guy who blew glass as a hobby for a while when he was younger, he used pre-made glass ingots for his glass blowing. Besides, he wasn't interested in helping the competition. The asshole. She had to find someone who could make glass. Community Center, Fort Plymouth, Trinidad, May 17, 320 BCE. Stella plugged her computer into the Ethernet port. There was a row of them with bench seats and little wooden half walls between them. It was where Stella did all her research, and after much consideration, she called up not Wikipedia nor Encyclopedia Britannica, but instead the post-event newsfeed, and did a search for glassmaking. What came up first on the search was glass baubles made in Carthage and Alexandria, and they're bought by the Queen and available for sale on their next landing at Fort Plymouth. Apparently, the Carthaginians were competent glassmakers. One thing that Stella knew from her reading was that glassmaking was easier if at least part of your mix was already made glass. She put in an order, but then she had a thought. She needed someone who knew how to make glass. Why not try to hire someone from Carthage? Or for that matter, anywhere in Europe where they made glass. She sat at her computer and wrote out an ad to hire a glassmaker. Then she called up the translation app for Phoenician. Wanted: skilled glassmaker to move to Fort Plymouth, Trinidad, New America. Then she added her name and how to get in touch with her. After translating it into Phoenician, she translated it into Greek, Egyptian, and Latin. Then she checked the price for sending a message to the Queen and cursed for 2 minutes straight. The price, even for text, was $20. Queen of the Sea, Port of Izmir, May 17, 320 BCE. Joshua Varner pulled the next message from the queue. It was an ad for a glassmaker. It wasn't the first of that sort of message. Over the last month since they left Trinidad, they'd gotten several requests for skilled craftsmen of one sort or another. This one, though, wasn't from the government. It was a private individual. Joshua forwarded it to Eleanor Kinney. Eleanor Kinney sat in her office checking her email. They were going to be shipping craftsmen to the New World if they could find them. The Indians, everyone knew the term was inappropriate, but it was still the one they wound up using because it was handy, mostly lacked the skills that they needed in Fort Plymouth, and the ship people certainly lacked them, skill being a completely different thing than knowledge. The question was how to get the people they needed. In the here and now, a lot of the skilled craftspeople were slaves. Not all of them, but the majority. Eleanor would have liked to start up an underground railroad, but that wasn't practical. A thought rose up in her mind, and she slapped the disgusting thing back down to the evils of her subconscious where it belonged. But it wouldn't stay slapped down.
We might have to buy slaves.
May 18th, 320 BCE. Lars Floden listened to Eleanor's proposal and turned to Marie easily. First, because this really wasn't his thing. And second, because it wasn't really a proposal so much as a plea for him to tell her it was all a bad dream and she didn't actually have to consider paying the bastards who kept slaves so that they could profit even more from their barbarity. He couldn't tell her that, and he couldn't quite bring himself to say, "Yes, pay the bastards." Marie looked at Eleanor.
I think that we may have to do so. But first we need to talk to Roxanne. And for that matter, Eumenes. And if she is available, Cleopatra. They, especially Cleopatra, will be more conversant with the local laws and customs.
Queen of the Sea, en route to Amphipolis, May 17th, 320 BCE. Roxanne looked around the private conference room where Cleopatra, Marie Easley, Lars Floden, Eleanor Kinney, and Dag Jacobsen sat. There was wine on the table, and Cleopatra was sipping hers, clearly to buy time. Of course, she was confused. She didn't have Roxanne's time with the ship people. She didn't understand how anyone could be as rabidly anti-slavery as they were. Cleopatra put down her wine glass and said,
"Well, certainly you can buy slaves. I had understood that you forbade slavery on the Queen and in New America."
"They do," Roxanne said. "They will be freeing the slaves once they buy them."
"Then why buy them?" Cleopatra asked.
"Wait. Do you imagine that slaves will be so grateful that they will work for you after being freed? Slaves are the most ungrateful people in the world. It's well known."
"Gee," Eleanor's voice dripped sarcasm. "Why wouldn't they work for free just because they didn't have to?"
Cleopatra looked at Eleanor, and Roxanne decided she should interrupt before things got heated.
"I told you, my friend,"
she waved at the ship people.
"On this, they are fanatics beyond reason.
And apparently beyond courtesy as well."
Cleopatra agreed, but her tone was more observant than harsh. She turned back to Eleanor and continued.
"However good you feel their reasons are, once freed, they will run off to their own endeavors. Buying a slave to ship to New America to work in one of your shops will get you no work if you free the slave. In fact, if you free the slave, the moment it boards your ship, it will turn around and walk right back off."
"What about contracts?" Dag asked. "I know I may be being corrupted by the locals, but crew on the Queen of the Sea signed on for at least a full voyage. They couldn't get to Port-au-Prince and quit their job without being in breach of their contract."
"A contract made under duress is invalid, and anyone signing a contract while a slave is, by definition, under duress. But you do bring up an interesting point, Dag. There were contracts of indenture. They were outlawed by the 13th Amendment to the Constitution of the United States, at least as the Supreme Court has interpreted it. And the UN also had rules against it. But there are still binding employment contracts. It could be done. A person could, as part of the deal to gain their freedom, sign an employment contract, with some part of their wages garnished to pay off the debt they incurred in borrowing the money to buy their freedom. But I guarantee it's going to end up in front of New America's Supreme Court, all three of the judges. And I can't guarantee that it will pass their muster."
"I doubt it will pass mine," Lars Floden said.
"I hate to say it," Eleanor Kinney said, "but you may have to reconsider if you want Fort Plymouth to survive, and even more if you want us to have any real role in the emancipation of slaves. Absent at least some acceptance."
She paused, clearly trying to find words that didn't make her feel like Nathan Bedford Forrest.
"Of a right to recompense, there is no motive for the people in New America to buy the freedom of slaves. It's wrong. I know it's wrong. But is it as wrong as just leaving them in slavery?"
Over the next few weeks, the radio was full of back-and-forth discussions, some public and some private, between the Queen of the Sea, the Reliance, and Fort Plymouth. It also included the personnel at the newly placed radio stations that the Queen was installing from Carthage to Babylon, and so, indirectly, involved the governments of the lands around the Med. Fort Plymouth, New America, June 20th, 320 BCE. Another bad batch. Stella Matthews was getting closer, though. The broken glass shard she had added to the mix lowered the heat needed and got her something that was almost glass. It was gray and cloudy, but almost translucent. It was even smooth on one surface. But it was also full of bubbles.
Just knowing the theory wasn't cutting it. She needed a professional. And so far as she knew, the only real glassmaking professionals in the world were in Europe and North Africa. She put her stuff away and dressed in her clothes from the crews that were by now approaching the status of rags and headed for the community center. Stella plugged in her computer and logged on to the email server. She had responses to her ad, but they weren't applicants. They were slaves. Slave owners, rather, offering to sell her qualified craftsmen for Queen of the Sea dollars. For now, Queen of the Sea dollars and New American dollars were effectively the same thing. They were worth exactly the same amount of silver. There were several offers. 2 Carthaginians, 3 Egyptians, and a Phoenician from Tyre. For just a moment, she wanted to get ready to stage a march on Al Wiley's office, and not a Martin Luther King Jr.-style peaceful protest. No, she was going to start the revolution. It wasn't news exactly. The New America Congress had passed a law saying that for the next 20 years, contracts of employment made with the express purpose of buying a slave out of bondage would be enforceable. And the 3 justices of the New America Supreme Court had approved the law by a 2-to-1 majority. And one of the guys voting yes was black, Justice Keith Robertson. The practice of buying and freeing slaves with advance on wages contracts was legal. The advance on wages weren't paid to the slave, but the slave owner. The advance on wages contracts were way too close to a contract of indenture to survive any American court back in the world. That type of deal was all over the news last week, including the fact that the slave had to agree for the sale to take place. Surprisingly, not all of them did. The thing she hadn't known about, or at least hadn't realized, was that the radio stations being installed all around the Mediterranean were used by the locals to buy and sell in advance. Everything from linen to slaves, back and forth between city-states and nations, whether the trades involved ship people or not. There were also advance on wages contracts where the contract employee was just getting the transport cost to Trinidad paid. Transportees could become citizens just like any other immigrant, if the person lived here for the 2 years needed and could recite the Bill of Rights in English and showed a basic knowledge of how the government worked through a standardized test. What Stella didn't understand was why anyone would want to come live in a town that was mostly a housing project, where the plumbing was non-existent and the only roads that were paved, even with just tar sand, were 7th Street and Garnet Avenue. And that had been done only after 2 people died because the ambulance carts got stuck in the mud. She went back to the ads. One of the Carthaginians had agreed to a contract for a 10-year period. The cost was high. 5,000 New American dollars plus transport costs. The only way she would be able to afford it was to sell her laptop. She had already sold her cell phone to the Queen of the Sea. Donald Carnegie's book reader was now owned by the community center, and Stella's mortgage on both townhouses was paid for the next year, along with the community dues that paid for her meals and the use of the center. Stella was a decisive woman when she had to be, and now she had to be. The truth was that the chickens hadn't come home to roost yet, but they would if she didn't do something. She checked the prices being offered by the Queen of the Sea, the government, and individuals for laptops, and pulled up the specs on her laptop to compare. She should be able to get around $11,300 for her computer. She unplugged her computer and headed up to the counter. Here in the computer center was a lock room, constantly manned, where items from back in the world and very expensive local items were stored for resale after being examined. Among the items was a 2-foot-tall, solid gold wall hanging in the shape of the sun. It weighed 22 pounds, and was worth rather less than any of the 150-plus computers stored there. It took them 2 hours to check out her laptop and do the paperwork, but by the end of the day, her account in the Bank of New America had an available balance of $10,200.98. That would change once the computer was put up for auction and actually sold. Then, using one of the publicly available computers, she bought the contract of indenture for Carthalo, a man owned by the Barca clan. The Reliance would pick him up on their way back. Carthalo was the cheapest on offer. Radio Room, Carthage, June 20th, 320 BCE. Tina Johnson read the notice off the computer screen and shook her head in disgust. Part of the deal was that she had to transmit and receive messages. Even messages that involved human trafficking. It was disgusting enough when the locals did it, but ship people ought to know better. Even as she thought it, she knew that she wasn't being completely fair, but she didn't care. Sure, she walked the streets of Carthage every day among slaves and slave owners. She had dinner prepared by slaves at least 3 days a week. But that didn't matter. She didn't own slaves. Put whatever face you wanted on Stella's advance on wages contract. It was buying a slave. And as agent for the station, Tina was going to have to go pay the present owner and pick up the slave. Carthalo woke up when the bucket of water was thrown onto him. No, not water. It was piss. He came up ready to fight, and the overseer laughed. It wasn't like he could reach the man. He was chained to the wall. The iron chain went from a bolt in the wall to a manacle around his ankle. He couldn't go after the bastard anyway, because his ankle was rubbed raw and infected, and none of it was his fault. What happened was an accident, pure and simple. Carthalo didn't push his owner's nephew into the furnace. The nephew bumped him. Carthalo was just trying to keep his balance.
You are a lucky bastard, Carthalo. You've been sold.
10 minutes later, sluiced down, but still wet and limping, Carthalo was led into one of the master's rooms. Not any slave quarters, this. And a woman was seated on a chair at a table. There was another chair, and Carthalo was motioned to it. He sat cautiously, and the woman began to talk. She would say a few words. Then the little box she carried would speak. It was not like anything he had ever heard of. He was to get his freedom, but not until he had worked for 10 years. There was a provision for him to buy himself free early by paying back the money she was paying for him. Carthalo figured he could do that. Before Padus Boca fell into the furnace mouth, Carthalo had several drachmas stashed away for work he did on the side. Maybe he was lucky. Besides, the woman who was buying him was attractive. He might be able to seduce her. Then he learned that he wasn't being bought by this woman. She was just acting as agent. He was going to sail on the Reliance. To New America. 214 to 216 12th Street, Fort Plymouth, Trinidad. June 30th, 320 BCE. Stella woke to a siren that lasted for almost a minute before it was shut off. Then the public address system reported native attacks on the outlying farmsteads. It also warned everyone to stay inside the walls and included a request for emergency housing. Stella got up, got dressed, and headed for the community center. She had extra room. In the community center, she was introduced to a farm family, Mrs. Banner and two kids, and four natives were assigned to her. They were especially worried about Brad Banner, who had stayed at the farm to try to protect their super turkeys. For the next 2 days, the town of Fort Plymouth was cut off from its outlying territories and invested by a force of locals from the River Orinoco. July 2nd, 320 BCE. They couldn't see the Indians, not even from the second-floor balcony. But they could see the arrows that the Indians were shooting, and they could see the troops on the parapet with their crossbows and occasional guns.
Fort Plymouth was crowded now, not only with all the passengers, but with the allied tribes. That was most of the tribes that lived on Trinidad. All of them who were close enough to get here before the Tupki and their allies invested the fort. Stella was watching the battle as best she could when the public address system announced that the Reliance was in the Gulf of Paria. Reliance, Gulf of Paria, July 3rd, 320 BCE. Carthello limped over to the side of the barge portion of the Reliance and helped hand bullets up to the steam cannon crews. He wasn't the only one. The Reliance had 20 passengers. About half of them were transportees like Carthello. The others were immigrants who wanted to go to New America, but couldn't afford passage on the Queen, often people who signed employment contracts to raise the fare. Still, Carthello was worried what would happen to him if the ship person who owned his contract died in the battle. They said he was a free man now, just one with an employment contract. But Carthello didn't really believe that. Trinidad Docks, July 4th, 320 BCE. Carthello walked across the gangplank to the long wooden dock that the Reliance was tied up to and was met by a ship person. He thought he could tell ship people by now. This one was a man who said his name was George Grosskopf. For the rest of the day, the transportees were herded from here to there, dropped off at various locations, until a local dressed in a loincloth and body paint led him to a house. Stella looked up from an argument between the two banner kids to see a man limping along with one of the Indians.
"He looks like a Tupki, but apparently one of the Tupki on our side."
In very broken English, the Tupki said,
"Your slave."
"He's not a slave," Stella insisted, and the Tupki shrugged and turned away, leaving a man with short cropped hair and a beard that was just starting to grow out standing there. Stella introduced herself, and best she could tell, the only words he understood were her name. She called Mrs. Banner to take care of her kids, and using gestures, she led Carthello through her townhouse to the kiln in back. It was better than walking around the block to get there. By now, her house had some furnishing, mostly local work. A table, some camp chairs, a chest with gourd mugs and wooden plates, even some wall hangings. All locally made. Stella wasn't spending her dwindling cash supply on things like glass cups or plastic trays. She noticed that Carthello was looking around curiously. And once they got out the back to the kiln and he was sure she didn't object, he examined it carefully. 214 to 216 12th Street, Fort Plymouth, Trinidad, July 23, 320 BCE. Carthello turned the knob that increased the amount of heated oil that was fed to the burner. This was the third day of the melt. One of the big things that Stella didn't know was how you could tell that you were melting the glass long enough and hot enough. You got them both by looking and seeing what it looked like. The trick Carthello used for heat was one he had learned back in Carthage. You took a wooden plank with a small hole in it. Then, as the light of the melt shone through it onto another piece of whitewashed wood, you looked at the color. You needed to do that at night, or you needed your kiln in a room, because daylight washed it out so you couldn't tell the color well. For time, you stuck a rod into the glass and pulled out a blob. If there were unmelted bits or too many bubbles, you needed to keep it melting longer. He needed the glass to glow a yellow closer to white at this part of the melt, so that the bubbles would be able to escape. Another day at the increased heat should do it, he thought. The idea of using oil to control the flame struck him as brilliant. At least it did now. His first reaction was that they should be using wood like they did in Carthage. He put the iron plate back over the opening in the kiln using tongs, then left the kiln and went back into the house. He had a room at the back of the house next to the back door. The whole place stank of tar. He thought of running away. He had thought of running away almost every day since he was sold into slavery at age 6. But usually only a passing thought. There was nowhere to run. Now, well, there was still nowhere to run. No one spoke his language except a few other transportees, and as was amply demonstrated by the battle being fought as he arrived, the Indians were dangerous. Besides, he had his own space, even if it stank of tar. He had meals and access to the community center. He could move on his own. He wore no chains or any mark that he was a slave. And he got paid. Most of his pay went to the debt he owed Stella for buying him, but he got some money every week. Not a lot, but enough to buy an extra glass of wine when he wanted one, or new clothing if he saved up. July 25th, 320 BCE. Stella watched as Carthalo shoved the big spoon into the melt. The spoon was a brass bowl with a long wooden handle and must weigh 20 pounds empty. Full, it was closer to 40. And as he walked with it, Carthalo jiggled it, tossing the glass blob up and out of the bowl with every step until he got to the stone table where he plopped it down. It was glowing red-orange and still very flexible as he used a pair of shears to cut off a smaller blob and put it in a ceramic mold. Then he pressed the other half of the mold onto it. If this worked, they would get a lens-shaped piece of clear glass. Carthalo then took a hand press made of iron and pressed the rest of the blob into a roughly flat sheet about 2 feet across. He used a knife to cut the glass into a square about a foot across. It didn't work. The glass was Coke bottle green. The lens shape was rough, and the lens had a dozen little bubbles in it. Carthalo was quite happy with it, though, insisting that with reheating and smoothing, it would make a lovely ornament that would fetch a good price. They weren't where they wanted to be, but they were in the glass-making business. Chapter 1. A War to Fight. Queen of the Sea. Forward Radio Room. November 2nd, 320 BCE. The radio printer clacked, and Joshua Varner jerked in his office chair. He couldn't get used to it. The Queen had arrived in this time, equipped with top-of-the-line laser printers, and they still had them. But to keep that happy state as long as possible, they had, over the past year, built printers using chips from anything they could scavenge. Dot matrix printers, which were slow and noisy. The radios sent digitally. That meant they could send anything from picture to voice to text, but text used the least bandwidth, and so was the most common. He was from the 21st century, and here he was in the 4th century BCE, using mid-20th century tech to receive what amounted to radio teletype from Rome about the Senate's response to Antigonus holding Babylon against Attalus. He rotated in his chair and scooted over to the printer. The roll of paper was held on the rubber cylinder with a serrated blade. He tore off the sheet. It was locally made rag paper. The words were in Latin, and Joshua couldn't read Latin. But the address was clear. He folded it, sealed it with wax and a stamp made by the machine shop, then called a new hire. Delivery for the Romans. Titus Venturus Calvinus. Titus took the sheet from the messenger and gave him a ship people dollar as a tip. Once the door to his cabin was closed, he used a fingernail to pop the wax seal and open the letter. He sat at the small desk in his room and read. From the office of the consuls. Rome will take no action regarding the conflict of the Diadochi. Make no promises to either side.
Any side, they should say, Titus muttered.
You will endeavor to obtain the designs for an electrical battery.
A battery of cannons would be easier.
Titus tossed the cable on the desk and picked up the phone.
Who do I see about a battery?
He muttered to himself again. Then, making up his mind, dialed a number. When the phone was answered, he said,
Caput, I have some scoop for you and I need a favor.
What sort of favor?
Rome wants batteries, the electrical kind. Who do you know, and what are your suggestions?
Capote Barca said, and Titus could imagine him playing with his fancy beard.
I think lead acid is probably your best bet. I'll have some names for you by lunch. Meanwhile, I'm going to send Carthage Rome's plans, once you give me the scoop.
2 hours later, Capote lay on his bed and read the Carthaginian response to his message. It was longer and more detailed, but amounted to much the same thing Titus got from Rome. The people back home were confident that with Alexander dead and the generals fighting each other, Carthage remained safe. Then Capote got to the next section.
Do all in your power to prevent the Romans from seeing the work going on in the military harbor. In this history, Carthage will not wait for the Romans to sow our city with salt. Insane, Capote thought.
Rome wouldn't be a threat for another 100 years, and by that time the world would have changed beyond all recognition. Capote stopped himself. No, that wasn't right. Rome had read the Butterfly Book too. They would know about the 3 Punic Wars, and would see Carthage as a threat, no matter what Carthage did or didn't do. As much as he hated the thought, the government might well be right. The effect of the Butterfly Book was to rush things, to push the world in decades into wars that would have happened over centuries. Had it not been for the Queen of the Sea. Queen of the Sea, Piraeus, Port of Athens, November 3rd, 320 BCE. Marie Easley looked around the conference room. Eumenes, Dag Jakobsen, and Daniel Lang were talking together, pointing at a map on the table. Eleanor Kinney, the chief purser for the ship, and Roxanne and Eurydice, the queen's regent of Alexander the Great's empire, were a couple of seats away. And all the way across the room, Olympias was scowling at all and sundry. She was greatly displeased that her stock of hallucinogens and other drugs had been taken. They were under lock and key in the pharmacy. Captain Lars Floden wasn't going to let the 4th century BCE's most famous poisoner keep her stock of poison while she was on the Queen, even if she was the mother of Alexander the Great. For the past few days, Eumenes had attempted to get the Queen of the Sea to take a force of his soldiers around the Horn of Africa, because he had 2 fires to put out, Cassander in Macedon and Antigonus in Babylon. There were radios in Rome, Carthage, Alexandria, and other places around the Mediterranean and Aegean Seas, but they didn't have any radios in Babylon or anywhere in the eastern stretches of the empire. Eumenes couldn't let Cassander consolidate in Macedonia, because Macedonia was the tail that wagged the dog of Alexander the Great's empire. But if Eumenes concentrated on Cassander, it would give Antigonus One-Eye time to cut the empire in half. To counter that threat, he wanted to remind the eastern satraps that they weren't safe, even if Antigonus held Babylon, for the Queen of the Sea could reach them anyway. Eumenes wasn't going to get what he wanted. The delegates from Antigonus One-Eye were lobbying just as hard against Eumenes, insisting that it was an internal matter. And for that matter, that Attalus' attack on Antigonus in Babylon had not been an authorized action, but little more than an act of banditry. They also argued that even if the queen's regent Roxanne and Eurydice were to rule against Antigonus, it was still an internal matter, and for the Queen of the Sea to interfere would destroy its neutrality. It was a good argument, as much as Marie might sympathize with Roxanne and Eurydice. Lars wasn't going to let the queen be dragged into the politics of the Diadochi, Alexander the Great's surviving generals, any more than could be avoided. Lars came in with Staff Captain Anders Dahl and took the seat at the head of the long oval table right next to Marie's seat. Anders took the next seat over. The position of Staff Captain was analogous to that of Executive Officer on a Navy ship or a cargo ship. But the way it was working out since the 21st century cruise ship Queen of the Sea arrived in the year 321 BCE, Staff Captain was going to be the title for Executive Officer in the future,
and exec was going to be ignored except by dusty old scholars like Marie. Marie felt her lips twitch at the thought. Lars gave Anders a look, and Anders said,
"If everyone will be seated, we'll get started."
Eumenes, Dag, and Daniel took their seats quickly, as did Eleanor, Roxanne, and Eurydice as well. Olympias went around the table to take the seat opposite to Lars, as though that were the head of the table. It was an obvious power play, and Marie looked at Lars. Lars let it pass. Whatever the changes over the last year and a bit, Lars had been a cruise ship captain for almost 10 years and an officer on a cruise ship for even longer. He was a polite man and willing to let others appear to score points, as long as they didn't actually interfere with the running of the Queen. That was one of the things Marie liked about Lars, even though she occasionally found herself wishing he would rip someone's head off, metaphorically speaking, when the situation required it. Lars had proven his willingness to do it literally. He had washed the decks of the Reliance in blood when pirates seized her, and used the Queen to turn a fleet of triremes into kindling. Once everyone was in the proper place, or close enough, Lars again let Anders say it.
"I'm sorry, General Eumenes, but the Queen of the Sea can't involve itself in the internal politics of the United Satrapies and States of the Empire. Quite aside from logistical concerns, which are real and serious, we have to maintain our neutrality, at least officially."
"Officially?"
Roxanne asked, lifting a sculpted eyebrow. She very much reminded Marie of Sophia Loren. Since the arrival of the Queen, she had added golden highlights to her black hair and now wore artfully applied makeup. Roxanne's lush but athletic figure was much the same as before her arrival, save perhaps a bit healthier. Roxanne liked to listen to audiobooks while she worked out in the cruise ship gymnasium.
"Officially," Lars agreed. "I've been in contact with President Wiley by radio, and New America expresses a willingness to ally with the USSE. On the basis of that, we will help where we can, within the limits of our situation. That doesn't mean using the Queen very much, I'm afraid, but we should be able to supply you with some gunpowder."
"Gunpowder," Eumenes said studiously, "is a flash in the pan."
Marie easily looked at the general in something partaking of both disgust and admiration. Disgust because the statement was patently ridiculous. Admiration because the expression flash in the pan was utterly unknown in 321 BCE, since it was based on a gunpowder misfire, the priming powder flashing in the pan but not igniting the charge. A bright flash, then gone with no effect. For Eumenes to use it here indicated that the man had managed to understand and internalize the concepts involved in a very short time.
"It will remain so till we get pans for it to flash in,"
Eumenes shook his head.
"And barrels to hold the charge and shot with touch holes to transfer the fire from the pan to the charge. It's like so much of what you brought, of great potential use, but needing an industry built before it can be used effectively. For now, what we can build will make a great display, but no real difference. We don't have cannons, and we don't have the means to make cannons in any numbers."
The Queen of the Sea was the only facility that was yet able to make the sort of cannons that were used in their time. Also, the only facility that could make cannons of any sort quickly. But aside from the steam cannons on the Queen and the Reliance, and some black powder cannons from Fort Plymouth, the Queen wasn't making cannons. It was making the tools to make the tools to make cannon. And most of those were made for and sold to New America. Cannons for Eumenes' army would be made by Greek craftsmen, hand-carved from bronze. Neither cheap nor fast.
"What about rockets?" Dag asked.
"A flash in the pan, as I said. Pretty fireworks, signifying nothing."
"Not necessarily," said Daniel Lang. "First, because we can make good rockets using venturi and fins to provide spin. We know how, and we have the basic technology here on the Queen. We even have a stock of venturi,
though a limited one. That will give you rockets almost as good as you might have found in World War I, or even World War II. Eumenes was looking interested, but Olympias interrupted.
What is World War? The only world-spanning war was my son's. There, Olympias,
Roxanne said.
You insisted on being here and promised to listen, not interrupt. I will have my say. I am Alexander's mother and Philip's wife. No,
said Marie as pedantically as she could manage.
You were Alexander's mother and Philip's wife. But your Philip and your Alexander are gone. Now Roxanne is Alexander's mother and regent, and Eurydice is Philip's wife and regent. You have paid your fare, but you are simply a passenger on the Queen of the Sea, not a ruling monarch.
Olympias stood and spoke in a version of Greek that was even more archaic than that spoken in the 4th century BCE, something that went back to Agamemnon or maybe Hercules. Assuming that there had at some point been actual men that Agamemnon and Hercules were based upon. She also waved her hands in obscure and spooky gestures. Marie stared at her. Then, quite unable to help herself, she started to laugh. Olympia stopped gesturing and speaking. She sat back down, not as though she had intended to, but simply as though shock left her legs unable to hold her up.
I'm sorry, Marie said, trying to get her laughter under control. Your error is in assuming that everyone shares your mythology. In the time we come from, essentially no one shares it. We have our own. I didn't mean to denigrate your beliefs, honestly, I didn't. But the gestures you were making looked like something that a carnival fortune teller might use.
Marie snapped her mouth closed about a paragraph too late, as she finally realized just how demeaning and infuriating her response would seem to Olympias. She looked into the woman's eyes and knew that she had just made a mortal enemy. Considering Olympias' history, mortal enemy wasn't hyperbole, not in the least.
To get back to the point, Anders said, we can provide you some black powder rockets, and you have the formula and techniques to make black powder.
Anders didn't sound thrilled about that last. The secret of black powder hadn't stayed a secret. It was listed in Wikipedia, and by now copies of the formula were available from Venezuela to Babylon. Nor was black powder the only ship people's secret that was no longer a secret.
What about cargo?
Eumenes asked.
What do you mean? Anders asked.
I mean I would like to buy wheat and rye here and have it delivered to Iskenderun so that Pharnabazus can keep the pressure on Antigonus while I go after Cassander.
The Queen is not a cargo ship, and we have a schedule we need to get back to, Lars said before Anders could. Also, if we deliver 50 tons or so of provender to the Mediterranean coast when your army isn't there to protect it, it's likely not going to be there by the time your army gets there, Dag said. You'd be better off hiring a local ship and maybe seeing if you can get a steam engine to move it. That way Pharnabazus can move his cavalry to meet the provision ship. It still means going to Izmir first.
The discussion continued and Eumenes didn't get what he wanted, but did get considerably more than Antigonus' representatives would have approved. Aridaeus would be livid if he knew how much Eumenes was getting in terms of ship credit. The Queen of the Sea had a great deal of silver and gold by this time, part of it from trading in Europe, but much of it from South America, where the locals used it as decoration. Gold was a soft, malleable metal, often with a pleasing color, and it was shiny, unlike lead. So masks and bracelets were made from it in South and Central America. The natives were happy to trade the yellow metal for steel knives on a pound-for-pound basis, at least at first. Eumenes would be getting some of that gold, but he would also be getting a drawing account that would be recognized throughout the Mediterranean. That was half of what the radio teams that the Queen was sending about the Med were for.
The amount in the account will be known,
Eumenes asked as he looked at the paper.
Not unless someone gets bribed, Eleanor Kinney said. Which could happen. How much is it?
Olympias asked. Eleanor looked at Eumenes, Eumenes looked at Roxanne, and so did Eurydice.
It's a drawing account, and it takes Eumenes to access it,
Roxanne said.
How much is in the drawing account?
Olympias asked, not to be put off.
That,
Eurydice said coldly,
is a government matter, and you're not a member of the government.
She turned to Roxanne.
I told you it was a mistake to let her in here. Please, everyone calm down,
Roxanne said. But from the looks Olympias and Eurydice gave each other, it was too late. Roxanne's suite. 1 hour later. Roxanne sat on the couch and said,
That was a mistake. It doesn't matter.
Eurydice shrugged.
You know what happened in that other history, and you know how Olympias felt about Philip's mother. There is nothing I can do to keep safe from her, not as long as we are both on this ship.
She glanced at Philip. Philip and Alexander were across the room. Philip was writing out equations in a combination of Greek and ship people English notation, while little Alexander sat across from him drawing nonsense on a small chalkboard. Roxanne leaned back.
You have decided then? There was never any choice. Not once Captain Floden let that woman on the ship. I will go with Eumenes.
I will go too, said Philip.
No, you stay on the ship, Eurydice said, where you'll be safe.
If it's not safe for you, it's not safe for me.
But the treatments,
Eurydice complained.
You're much better than before, and I don't want you to lose that.
Philip considered.
I will miss the computers more. We can take the squeeze box with us, and I can do maths for the army. I won't have the drugs, but the doctor says that she wants to wean me off those as soon as possible.
The drugs were anti-anxiety drugs, basically low-dose morphine, designed to let Philip interact with the world without going into hysterics.
Besides, we can get weed if I need it. The doctor says it's been in use in Egypt for centuries and made its way to Greece as well.
Eurydice laughed, because she knew perfectly well that Greek soldiers had been using cannabis for recreational purposes since they first passed through Egypt over a decade ago. Captain's suite, Queen of the Sea.
I don't trust that woman, Lars Floden said to Marie easily as they sat on his couch.
I know, and I shouldn't have laughed.
Marie took a sip of wine.
But she looked ridiculous.
I don't disagree, but that doesn't change the fact that we have a mass murderess on board.
By now, word had reached them about the sack of Amphipolis and what Olympias had done. It fit together all too well with her previous reputation. Whether she had used drugs, magic, or the power of suggestion, her slaves and servants had run amok and died to the last man, all the while setting the city on fire even before Cassander breached the walls.
Mass murderers are not uncommon in this time, Lars, Marie said. I think I've mentioned that before. In fact, I'm almost sure I have.
It may have come up in the occasional offhand comment, Lars agreed. Then muttered, about a million times.
The problem is, Lars, that you too are a mass murderer now. Remember the steam guns turned on the Reliance and running over the galleys in Alexandria Harbor?
That was war, Lars stopped.
Yes, it was, and you were right to do it in both cases. But by Olympia standards, she was right too.
Oh, nonsense, Lars said. I'm as willing to accept cultural differences as the next screaming liberal, but drugging your slaves to go on a rampage is not the same thing as shooting people who are engaged in an act of piracy.
No, it's not. Not to you and not to me. But to Olympias, it was simply a tactical maneuver to cover her escape, and the slaves were collateral damage.
Marie held up the wine glass in a wait gesture.
I'm not justifying it or approving of it or excusing it. None of those things. All I am saying is that it's the way most of the people we are going to be dealing with think, here and in Trinidad, all around the world. And just calling someone like Olympias a nutjob is not nearly precise enough. and that will lead us into tactical errors in dealing with her and the others like her.
So what am I missing?
She is an incredibly smart nutjob. One who has survived a snake pit for decades by being the most venomous snake in the pit. The question is, can she adapt to a world that isn't all a snake pit? If she can, she could be very useful. And even if she can't, she has connections and alliances enough that killing her would be incredibly dangerous. Not to mention wrong in the same way her poisoning all those people was wrong.
She hates you now. I want you to promise me that you'll be careful around her.
Lars hugged Marie tightly.
I don't want to be without you.
Oh, I will. I think I'll see about borrowing one of Roxanne's silver shields.
Queen of the Sea. Port of Izmir, Smyrna. Nursery in Roxanne's suite. Dawn. November 5th, 320 BCE. Eumenes reached down and tickled his son Sardisius in his crib.
Daddy has to go away for a while, but you get to stay on the ship with the ship people and learn their magic. And you will have baby Alexander to play with and all the other children. Not bad for the grandson of a wagoneer. Grow well, my son. Grow strong.
Then, not letting himself cry, Eumenes turned away and went aboard the lifeboat, now used as a ship's boat, that would take him to shore. Eumenes, Eurydice, Philip, a small company of personal guards, and the radio crew boarded the ship's boat for the trip into shore. The Bay of Izmir was not nearly deep enough for the Queen to navigate safely. It took only 5 minutes for the boat to get to the dock, but an hour to unload. Erika Mirzadeh was supervising the unloading with the help of several silver shields, the veteran elite infantry of Alexander's army. With them was another ship person named Takaran Bayot. Takaran was 5'7", thin-faced, with a goatee and curly black hair, black eyes, and skin that fell between olive and light brown. He had straight white teeth and an engaging smile. He wore khaki pants with pockets on the sides of the legs and a khaki shirt with big button-down pockets, all of which were full. There was the radio system.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.